So this is Math 30S Applied for the period 14 to 18 February. Of course, use it in conjunction with your notes and assignments. So 14 February, there it was for the ladies at the Valentine, Systems of Linear Equations. That's what we're working on in our Unit C. And we got a practice test to play with as well. And we got a practice exam for the end of the course as well. So there's the plan for the 14th. So let's do a review of the systems of linear equations. If you've got two unknowns, you need two facts, two equations to solve them. And we can solve them using graphing. We can solve them using the substitution method, the elimination method, and there are other methods too. So the first thing we do, of course, is label our equations. We'll just graph it here and show you what it looks like. Hopefully you know how to graph lines by now. I've been at this for months now, and there's more lines to come in Unit D. So if you do it on the TI-83, use second trace. Now it's intersect, not interest. All right, disregard the interest, it's intersect. And it'll tell you the answer is 4, 3. So let's see if that's true. You should always check your answer. If the x is 4 and the y is 3, would that work? Is 3 the same as 4 minus 1? Yeah, that works in equation 1. And is 2 4s plus a 3 equal to 11? Yep, sure is. So that's a solution. Your graphing calculator will tell you. Or you could have done it by hand too on a graph paper. Let's do it. Same equations using substitution. So the steps, as per your reference notes, which you're always allowed to use on tests and exams, label the equation, isolate one of the variables, plug that variable into the other equation, and solve. So there's what we're doing. We solve for x by plugging it into equation 2. We took equation 1, plugged it into equation 2, calculated the x, and then plug it back into either of the original equations. And of course, you should always check your algebra. Right? That's the beauty of algebra. You don't leave an answer key and check to see if your answer did work. Sometimes checking is harder than the actual algebra to solve it, though. Alright, so there's what you got. Two happy faces, it worked. Substitution method. Let's try the elimination method with the same formulas. So recall the elimination method is the aim is to eliminate one of the variables. So the first thing to do is label your equations. Easier to talk about them. Put them in some sort of a standard order so you can see if anything's going to cancel something. So we line up your x's, then y's, and I put constants on the other side of the equal sign. And I notice that if you took equation 1 and subtracted equation 2, that you would eliminate the y. So we did that. We took equation 1, subtracted equation 2. End up with negative 3 x's, and a y, take away a y, is nothing. And you end up with negative 12. Seems to me like x is 4. So that's what we did. We added or subtracted the equations so that something got eliminated, one of the variables. And we solve for that variable. And then once we found the one variable, we plugged it back into either equation. And of course, you should always check your answer. But we've already checked this how many times already. So a little happy face there, it does work. And some more stuff, word problems, assignment Charlie 6. Oh, this one was crazy. Yeah, this word problem said 3 more than a numerator divided by 3 more than a denominator equals 2/3. And 2 less than a numerator divided by 2 less than the denominator equals 1/2. So what is the numerator and the denominator? Well, let's number the equations and let's mess about with them, get them in some more reasonable equation there, something that we recognize. So here, I'm just tweaking up equations 1 and 2. And I'll just put them into the slope and intercept form, actually. Here they come. I'll speed this up. There you go. So you got two equations. N is 2/3 of a d minus 1. And the other equation is, well, no, n is 1/2 of a d plus 1. So you're going to plug the one n into the other equation. Well, first we graphed it there on the left. Using the TI-83, we graphed it, and we determined that the answer was 12,7. And now we'll do it by substitution. There was your two equations. Wherever you see an n in the second equation, you're going to plug in 2/3 of a d less 1. You come up with the answer. It's sort of like grade 9 algebra. You plug that d back into either of the equations to calculate the n, and look at that. It gives you the same answers, 12 and 7. Okay, now this one here, this word problem was crazy. I even messed it up the very first time there, and I fixed it while we were at break. So, you gotta know how to make expressions out of words. I mean, otherwise math is sort of useless, unless you just do it for fun. So you gotta take words and turn them into mathematical expressions. So twice the sum of two numbers exceeds 3 times their difference. Well, in order to calculate what we're looking for, we better give them names. We'll give them letters. A is the first number, B is the second. So when I say that twice the first number exceeds 3 times their difference, so A plus B is the sum, so 2 times the sum is twice the sum of the two numbers, exceeds, that means is more than. Which means if you took away 3 times their difference, and the word difference means subtract, then that difference is 8. All right, so that sets up the first equation. Second equation says half the sum. Okay, well, here comes the sum, A plus B. So there's half of the sum right there. Is 1 more than the difference. So the difference is means equals, 1 more than the difference. There's the difference, and there's 1 more than the difference. All right, so we'll play around with equation number 1, tweak it up a bit so it's something a little more manageable. Okay, and here's where I fixed it after the break. I actually threw in the 3 as well. I neglected to put in the 3 times the difference in the first equation. So there's the two equations. Solve them. And here they come. Here's the solution to those, to that silly word problem. Let's use elimination. So line things up in a standard order. Decide what you want to eliminate. I decided to take equation 1 and subtract 2 of equation 2. And I end up with B equals 3. And once I get the B equals 3, you plug it back into either original equation, and it will tell you what the answer is for the other variable. So we plug that back in. So we plug the B equals 3 in, and we end up with 7. So 7 and 3 are the answers to the question. Oh, I hate these ones. No, actually, I like these ones. 6 years ago, Bob was 4 times as old as Mary. In 4 years, he'll be twice as old as Mary. How old are they now? Well, if you're going to be calculating things, you better give them names. There's 2 things we don't know, Bob's age now and Mary's age now. Call them B and M, or X and Y, whatever. So the first sentence gives you the first fact or equation. It says that 6 years ago, Bob was, well, 6 years ago would be B minus 6, because B is his age now, so B minus 6 would be 6 years ago. Was means is, in the past. So that's an equal sign. Four times as old as Mary. Well, 6 years ago, Mary was today's age minus six, so M minus six times four. There you go. The second equation says in 4 years, so 4 years from now, well, right now he's B, so 4 years from now he would be B plus four. And he will be is in the future. So that's an equal sign, twice as old as Mary. So Mary in 4 years from now will be M plus four. So it should be twice as old, or he will be twice as old as she, rather. So you end up with those two first equations there, and then we're going to tidy them up a bit and make them into something more manageable. There we go. There's equation one. B is 4m's less 18. Equation two, B is 2m's plus 4. Let's solve them. What method did we use here? I don't recall. I think we just used... elimination. Yeah. Or we could have used substitution. It would have been the exact same equations, right? Yeah. Or you could have graphed it, too. It would have looked like this if you'd graphed it. Don't forget, when you're graphing, sometimes if you can't see the solution, you'll have to adjust your window. So zoom, zero, fit often will give you a pretty good window. No, but you'll have to play with it from there. But zoom, zero, fit will get you in the ballpark if you're graphing. Okay, unit C. More practice. This is part of the practice test because the test is coming up. Test is Thursday. So, here's a practice test question. Okay, well now I've messed up the software here. Here we go. We'll just let this explain itself. You know how to do this. And there I'm checking the answer at the top. I'm pretending the X is a 1 and the Y is a negative 2 and plugging them in. Better work. Forget, here's the 15th. Do some budgets and investments again, too. Here's the answer. Here's one of the questions on our practice test. Looked like that. We'll run it. We'll animate it now. So knowing how to draw lines is kind of important. Notice we get the solution here is at negative 2, comma 3. And let's do it on the graphing calculator. Now, of course, on a graphing calculator, it wants to have functions. It just wants to know y is a bunch of stuff. So you had to take equation 2 and convert it into a y isolated by itself. So it can evaluate and just blindly calculate a bunch of y's that go with any particular x. So calculators aren't that smart. Anyway, you plug those into the calculator, and it gives you the same answer. Let's try this one here. I'll animate it. Solve the system of equations using substitution. And clearly state the solution. A lot of times I go looking around the paper, the exams, and I'm going, where the heck is the answer? I can see they've got it right, but where is the answer on here? So put a box around it or something, help me out a bit. So to substitute, I decided to get the x by itself, so I got the x in equation 2 by itself. Recall that getting the thing you isolate, it's smarter to do whatever has a 1x in front. You can isolate any of those four variables there, you know, either the two x's or the two y's, but if you tried to isolate those other things, you'd end up with, well, fractional expressions, and it can be done. But always try to isolate something with a 1x or the 1y. Anyway, we did the following steps. We calculated the x, we took that x, we plugged it into the other equation. So we substituted it in. Now we can calculate, so that told us what the y was. So we calculated the y, a little bit of grade 8 algebra, y ended up being 0. People often don't like having 0 as an answer. They think they messed it up. 0's a legal number. Heck, it's my bank account most of the time. Then once you calculate the y, you plug it back into equation 2. Or you could have plugged it back into either equation, but equation 2 looks a little simpler. So I plug it back in, and it tells me the x is 5. So the solution is 5, 0. And you would check the answers, of course, by plugging them back in. And it does work. 3 5s plus 4 0s is 15. And 0 minus a 5 is 0 minus a... How'd that work here? 3 minus... I ended up with x equals 5. So 5, so 5 minus a 0 is 5. Yeah, so it does work. Yeah. Let's try this one here. Solve the following system of equations. I said use elimination, so line them up in some standard order. Decide what you want to eliminate, so I decided to take 2 of equation 1, so I doubled all of equation 1 and subtracted equation 2. That will magically get rid of the x's, so I solve for the y. Once I got the y, I plug it back into the original equation, either one of them, and it will tell you the x. So x is negative 2. You should check your answers. Look, I'm doing it now. Got some happy faces happening here. Slide. We'll animate this. Or you could have done it this way. You could have decided to eliminate the y's instead. So if you'd have taken 3 of equation 1 and 2 of equation 2, notice how the y's would both be 6y in both equations, and you'd be able to eliminate them by subtracting. There's actually 4 different ways to do all this. This particular problem. So you could be doing it one way and your buddy next to you could be doing it another way. You'll all end up with the same answer. No? Whatever you got to do to eliminate one of the variables. Next question looks like that. Animate it. Boom. So you want to get a cell phone plan. Who's going to be cheaper? Well, first thing to see is when do they cost the same? So at 100 minutes, both plans will charge you the same amount of money. And we did that by elimination. And how many minutes will the two companies charge the same total? Well, that's what we calculated. So at 100 minutes, your bill will be $20 for both of them. That's when they're both equal. That's when the two plans are the same. And then I asked you, well, what happens if you only use 60 minutes? Which company is cheaper? Well, you just plug them back into your two formulas. Turns out company A will be cheaper. if you only use 60 minutes. And of course, I show you a graph. I showed you you could have solved some of this just on a graphing tool online. I've given you about 5 or 6 of those. Now, the graphing tools aren't exact, of course. This one said the answer was 99.42 minutes for a cost of $99.94. All right? Or, correction, $19.94. So, usually calculators will, you know, won't be exact, like if you did it with real math. Here we go. Let's try some more of these number problems. Whoop, I missed it. There we go. Let's animate it. Two numbers. Their sum is 57. Their difference is 17. Find the numbers. Well, give them names. A and B. Hard to calculate things if they don't have names. Check your answer. It does work. A is 37, B is 20. Here's the next slide. So don't forget, Monday is a holiday. Right, so the 21st of February is a holiday. And we're going to do some money TVM, true value of money solving, and we're going to do some more practice testing there. Okay, for the unit C test. So we did some TVM, value of money exercises. There is an app on your TI-83 that will calculate loans and mortgages and stuff like that. So we played about with that. I don't have too many slides on here for it. Okay, let's try some more of our practice test then. After we finish the TVM stuff, we did the practice test. We'll animate it. Here you go. Here's two equations, and we're going to graph them. Just graphing lines. You get the y-intercept is, and you get the y-intercept, and you get the slope. So you graph your lines. Seriously, if you don't know how to graph a line yet, you really do have to get back into that. Here you go. Let's do the next slide. It looks like that. We'll animate it now. There's the first line, line one. There's the second line. And we could check by using the substitution method too. Not check it, but solve it another way using substitution. And sure enough, substitution. You just take the y and plug it into the other y. Tells us the answer is x equals 1, y equals 1. Surprise, surprise. That just happens to be where the lines cross as well. Next slide. Animate. So the first equation has an intercept of 2 and a slope of 1. Over 1, up 1, over 1, up 1. The next one is just a constant vertical line. Equation 2 is just a vertical line. X equals negative 3. And where do they cross? Well, as long as you're using a ruler and being a little accurate, you'll see they cross at negative 3, comma negative 1. And you should check your answer. Is negative 1 equal to negative 3 plus 2? It certainly is. And is negative 3 equal to negative 3? Yeah, it is. Next slide. Animate. Now we have some lines, but they're not in the slope and intercept form. They're in the x and y intercept form, or what we call the general form as well. So usually doing up a table with x's and y's works nicely. And if you take your x of 0 and your y of 0, that sure makes life easy. Multiplying by 0 is pretty slick. Alright, so what happened here? Where'd my other one go? I'm missing a slide here. The software has failed. We'll carry on here. Next slide. We're going to warm up for the unit test. Today's the unit test. What happens if a plane flies east 1,000 miles, so like Winnipeg to Toronto, in 4 hours, and it takes 5 hours to come back into the wind? So what is the speed of the airplane? What is the speed of the wind? And we had solved that. And here is, here's some examples in our budgets and investment notes. All right. How to plan a family budget, how to convert weekly amounts to monthly amounts, multiply by 52, divide by 12, how to calculate quarterly amounts and turn them into monthly amounts, etc., annual amounts, just divide by 12 to convert them into monthly amounts. Here's a simple interest problem. Canada savings bonds are often simple interest. The last time I bought one. There you go. So if you can hide away $2,000 in your sock drawer, one of these Canada savings bonds, after 20 years, you'll earn $2,900 in interest plus the $2,000 that it's worth. You'll have $4,900. It's just a nice thing to do for your nephew or your whoever. Now, did I mess this one up? Oh, here we go. Animate. So Kevin wants to buy a car, $1,500, but of course he doesn't have a credit history because he's a young guy. So the bank says, well, we don't know who you are. We're not giving you any money. So he goes to his uncle, and his uncle says, sure, I'll loan you some money. He says, well, I'll charge you some interest, of course, because I could be doing something else with the money. So 6% is pretty reasonable. And, you know, just come back in 2 years and give me the money. So your uncle obviously trusts you. He's not making you pay every month. He just says, bring back my principal plus my interest in 2 years, and that'll be good. So how much is it going to cost if he borrows the $5,800? There you go. Here's the calculation. Now here's the one with the charge cards. All right, you got some of this in your notes too. But charge cards can be nefarious. Let me animate this. If you got a charge card, you better be very certain what you're doing with it. Notice how, you know, you got your, you put your $2,400 on your plasma TV or whatever it is, and boom, you have some credit, the interest charges. Well, if you just keep filling up this table to see what you pay and what they charge you for interest, you'll discover towards the end that you pay out $359.40. But even though you paid out $359.40, only $128 of it actually killed off the debt. So really, $230 of it, just in the first 4 months, was just interest. So you borrowed this money, and you only paid off a third of it. So when you make a payment, only a third of your payment actually goes toward the debt. The rest goes to interest. This particular, you know, if you kept paying the minimum payment, it would take you decades to pay this off. And it would cost you, yeah. Well, we could have done the math. Your $2,400 entertainment center would end up being like $5,000 by the time you do the math. Okay? So you better be careful with charge cards. Next slide. So we're starting, well, we're continuing a new unit called linear programming. Funny enough, you gotta know how to do lines. And here's what it's all about. Say we sent Edwin to the store. And we said, go get us some donuts, would you? And we're thinking maybe maple or chocolate. So this is a simple example. We send Edwin to the store to get some maple or chocolate donuts. And we say, get us at least 10 donuts. So we don't say how many to get, we just say at least. So that means 10 or more donuts. So how many donuts could Edwin get us? Well, we could do a table. Tables work for everything. 5 maple, 5 chocolate, 1 maple, 9 chocolate, 10 and 10, 6 and 12. Hey, how about a million of each? All we said was at least 10 donuts. He could actually go get 2,000 of each kind if we... And he'd be obeying our instructions. He'd be satisfying our instructions. Well, how do you graph that sort of thing? Well, here we go. You just graph it like a line. He could have got 0 maples and 10 chocolates, or he could have got 10 chocolates and 0 maples. And it turns out that everything to the top side of that line there is a solution to our instructions. So that's how you graph. And then it ends up, you gotta color the answer, or make a region for the answer. There's an infinite number of answers. So how can you be wrong if there's an infinite number of answers? Next example, animate. This is on assignment Delta 1. Is that how you spell assignment? Oh yeah, D1. So I ask you to graph these two inequalities. So you just pretend it's an equal sign. And you graph it like a regular everyday line. And then to decide which point to decide which side to shade, you do a test point and see which side of the half of the universe is satisfies it and which half doesn't. So I tried 0, 0. So would 6 zeros plus 2 zeros be more than 6? Nope. So since 6 zeros and 2 zeros isn't more than 6, then the point 0, 0 is not an answer. And if it's not an answer, then no points on that side of the line are an answer. So you shade the opposite side, the other side of the line. So we're going to shade the top side of the line. Here we go. So all kinds of points on the right side work, 10, 10, and but anything below the line does not work. Next slide. Try it again. X minus 2y is greater than or equal to 0. Let's graph it. So you draw the line as if it's just a rig. You draw the inequality, rather, as just as if it's a line. X minus 2y is 0. And we do a standard t-table, but notice we get 2 points, 0, 0, and 0, 0, so it's 2 points, but they're the same point. So in this case, you had to pick one other y. So 0x and 0y won't work in this particular instance. So you just picked another point and came up with a y that goes with it. And then you do the test point. Obviously, we can't do 0, 0 again because it's right on the line. And we tested for 3, 6. I think that was Matthew's favorite test point. And is 3 minus 2 sixes greater than or equal to 0? No. So that means any point above the line is not satisfying that inequality. So it turns out that none of the points on that side, on the top side of the line, satisfy the equation. So the only points that satisfy it are below the line. So you shade in the bottom. Let's try another one. Animate. You guys did this one that's in your notes. Just pretend that the inequality is an actual equality, a line, in other words. Let's graph it. So we found 2 points on the x and y intercepts. We connect the points, that's called a line. We shade which side? Let's do a test point. And 0, 0 is my favorite. I'm very good at multiplying by 0 and subtracting 0. Is 0 less than 9? Sure is. Therefore, 0, 0 satisfies the equation, therefore all its neighbors, all the points on that side of the line, satisfy that equation. So you shade it in. Let's do another. This is the last one on the handout that we did on the assignment here. Let's calculate a couple intercepts. The x is 0, the y is 0. Connect the dots. Boom, boom. What side do we shade? Well, let's take a test point. Me, I like 0, 0. You can take whatever you want as a test point, provided it's not on the line. Is 10 zeros plus 40 zeros more than 20? No. So evidently that origin there, the 0, 0 is on the wrong side of the line. It's not a solution. So you must go to the other side, and everything to the right of the line, or to the top of the line, is the solution. And you can do the same in a graphing calculator. The graphing calculator will actually draw in the color in the region for you with different bars. All right, I showed you how to do that. You just cursored left to the symbol that it uses to plot. So whether it's dots or bold or a thin line, you can actually tell it to shade above a curve or below a curve. So it doesn't tell you the answer. You've got to figure out what the answer is and then tell the computer what side to shade. So it's not as smart as you. Right, but it does work on the TI-83 graphing calculator. Here's another one. Let's run this beast. Animate. It's on the assignment. And usually if there's an equals part to the equation, to the inequality rather, inequation, you make a solid line because the line itself is part of the solution. If it's a dashed line, it means that the line is not part of the answer. All right, so if there's an equals part to the inequality, then you make a solid line. Otherwise, it'd be dashed. There you go. We've done that before. Next slide. Let's try this one. We'll animate it here. Y is less than or equal to 2/3 of an x minus 1. There's your intercept, the negative 1. There's your slope, 3 over, 2 up, 3 over, 2 up. It's a rise over a run. Let's do a test point. I like 0, 0. You can use whatever you want. You could have used 0, 10 or something. All right. So my test point was not a solution, so it was on the wrong side. So I just shade everything else. Next slide. Well, we're back to practicing for our final exam, and we're not going to have time to do a test for the budgets and investments, but the final exam will certainly have budgets and investments on it. So here's Amanda buying a car. How much will her payments be? Now, you could plug it into that app on the TI-83 graphing calculator, and it would tell you. Or we have some tables you can use too that you look up. So when you look up on the tables, it turns out Amanda's going to pay $20.05 for every 1,000 she borrows. So, all right. So she's borrowing 14,000. Seems to me she's going to be doing 14 times 20.05. So her payments will be $280.70 a month. And if you multiply that by the 5 years, that's 60 payments. She'll end up paying $16,842 for her $14,000 car. So that's fair. I mean, for 5 years, you know, for the privilege of having used somebody else's money, it's going to cost you $2,800. That's how banking works. Next slide. This is the warm-up practice for the test. All right. If calculating this plane speed and the wind speed. So if the plane plus the wind is 250, correction, if the plane plus the wind is 250 miles an hour going to Toronto, and if the plane take away the effect of the wind is 200 because you're coming back into the wind, then how much is the plane speed and how much is the wind speed? So we calculate here that the plane speed is 225 and the wind speed is 25. I can animate that real quickly here. Yeah, of course, you've got to understand that speed is distance per time, and that 1,000 miles in 4 hours is the same as 250 miles an hour. So there is a little bit of physics involved that, you know, distance divided by time is speed. I think anybody that drives a car knows that. All right, so we got you working more on your practice exam after you finish the test here. And then we did some more TVM, time and value of money. And we did it on the calculator. There's an app on the calculator. There's probably an app on everybody's iPhones, for those who can afford those, that does this stuff. Notice how if you buy a house for $150,000, for example, at 9% interest, now these days it's only around 4%, but another couple months or years from now, it's going to leap up to there. I remember back in the 80s when it was 15% interest, and people were losing their houses left and right. So any event, the bottom one there, $150,000 house at 9%, paying for it over 30 years, you'll make payments of $1,206 a month, and it's eventually you'll end up paying out $434,500-ish for your $150,000 house. So that's sort of normal. You usually end up paying three times what something's worth if you take it on credit for a long time. So taking things on credit for a long time is going to cost you money. Let's just animate that because it's kind of funky. All right, we'll quickly animate that. We did this all on the graphing calculator. It's got apps on it. There's lots of apps online. I showed you all the applications online and my website too that do this. There's all kinds of mortgage calculators and loan calculators on your bank site, or any site has lots and lots of mortgage calculators or bank loan calculators or car payment calculators. So there, a house at 4.5% for 30 years is $760 a month. But if the mortgage rates jump up, like they're bound to in the next little while, you could end up paying $1,200 a month. So you should be planning on having a little bit like $500 a month slush left over. Because you may not be able to afford your house if you encounter high interest rates. So personal loans, we did that, 6%, $10,000 rather, at 6% over 5 years. TI 83 says it's $193.40. And there you go. Look, a standard table says it's $193.42. So this is $1,934 per thousand. So if you're taking a $10,000 loan, it's going to be 10 times as much, $193.40. Next slide. Okay, so now we're back to linear programming. It involves graphing inequalities. So if you walk in and say, if I want to hire you and I say, how much do you want to be paid? You'd say, I want my pay. So when I asked Matt there, he says, oh, I want my pay to be $20 an hour. And I said, oh, darn, that's too bad. The job pays more than that. I guess you didn't want that. Right? So there's a difference between saying I want my pay to be $20 an hour or my pay to be greater than or equal to $20 an hour. Right? More than or equal to $20, at least $20 an hour. right? So how do you handle expressions like, I want my pay to be at least something? All right, so then we looked at the notes there. If you're going to run a company that makes t-shirts, like long sleeve shirts and short sleeve shirts, how many of each kind of shirt do you make? This is all in your notes. How do you maximize your profit? How do you maximize your efficiency? How do you get the most out of your workers? So, and you don't want any of your machines sitting idle or any of your workers sitting idle. You just want to maximize your profit. Optimum productivity. Resource management. You want to effectively use all your resources. Well, how do you do that? That's what this unit's all about. And it starts with drawing lines. But anyway, we tried a couple samples here. We had a few folks try. Who was it? Somebody said, oh, let's do 12 of one and 15 of another. And we calculated what their solution was. And it turns out that, they make $22 profit. But, oh, man, look, they had 27 idle minutes on the cutting machine and 9 minutes idle on the stitching machine. So they got workers and machines sitting around for 27 minutes and 9 minutes doing nothing. Well, if people are sitting around doing nothing, you're not using maximum efficiency. Here's the optimum answer, and I think it was Jerry actually got this one. And he admitted he stumbled across it. That's good. You can solve many problems by guessing and checking. So he came up with 12 long sleeve and 24 short sleeve shirts. And that actually does end up being the optimum solution. You get the maximum profit. You're fully utilizing all your workers and all your machines. There's the perfect answer. Those are the type of questions we're going to learn how to do to maximize our efficiency. And just a quick review of what those inequality signs mean. 4 is greater than 2. In other words, since 4 is more than 2, the wider part of the inequality goes with the bigger number. 3 is less than 5. 2 is greater than or equal to 2. Okay? That's what that means. Next slide. You can do algebra with inequalities as well. If I said 3x plus 6 is less than $12, so like 3 boxes of Cheerios plus $6 is less than $12, how much is a box of Cheerios? Well, let me animate that last one. You can do it on a number line, and it's just like regular algebra. You're just going to get that 6 to the other side. Subtracting it, you're going to divide the x by 3, the 3x by 3 to get an x by itself. So x is less than 2. So you give me any number less than 2, like 1 or 0 or negative 10 or 0.325, any number less than 2 will make that equation true. It satisfies it. Let's try the next one. 2x plus 2 is less than or equal to negative 10. Animate. It's regular everyday algebra. You're just going to move the 2 to the other side by subtracting 2. You're going to divide the 2x by 2 to get a 1x, because that's what you're trying to do. There you go. So it turns out that if you give me any x that is less than or equal to negative 6, that will satisfy that equation. That will make that equation, it's not an equation, it's an inequation, true. And notice I colored in the dot, because in this case, the answer is actually allowed to equal negative 6. So since it's allowed to be less than or equal to negative 6, you color in the dot. Next slide. A bit more algebra here. Negative 5x subtract 4 is greater than 6. Do the standard algebra. Look at what you get. It says that x is greater than 2. And then you look at it and you say, well, hold on. That doesn't make sense. x is greater than 2. So like 0 would work. Negative 5 zeros minus 4 is greater than... Negative 4 is greater than 6. Whiskey Tango Foxtrot. So there is one extra rule in inequalities. If you divide both sides by a negative number, you actually have to reverse the direction of the inequality. So inequalities have that one extra rule, and there's another one actually, but inequalities have that one extra rule. If you divide both sides by a negative number, you have to flip the inequality. Okay, it's the same as if you take the reciprocals of both sides too, you gotta flip the inequality. But let's try this one. Just let it run itself. Standard algebra. But we divided by negative 1 on both sides, so you've got to change the direction of the inequality symbol. And it turns out that if you picked any number that was less than, or it's allowed to equal, negative 2, and plug it into that inequality up top, that will satisfy the inequality. It is a solution. Any number less than or equal to negative 2. And we did some more graphing here. This was the next day, and we had somebody buying donuts. Just a quick review of what we'd done the day before. If we sent somebody off this time and said, buy at most 10 donuts. In other words, 10 donuts or less this time. Not quite the same as we did with Edwin yesterday. So there's all the possibilities. You could buy 10 maples, 0 chocolates, 0 maples, 10 chocolates, 5 and 5, 2 and 2. Hey, you could buy 0 and 0. Because if I say buy less than or equal to, you could just pocket the money and buy nothing. There you go. Here's how you solve that and show the solution. And last slide. We'll graph this one. Animate. There we go. I'm given it in standard form. This time I'm going to convert it into the slope and intercept form by moving the 4x to the other side. This way I can actually put it in a calculator too. And the graphing calculators are very good at evaluating numbers. Here we go. So I try a test point so I can figure out what side to calculate, to shade rather. And my favorite test point of 0, 0 does not satisfy the equation. Therefore, I have to shade the opposite side, the side that does not have 0, 0 in it. So that's the end of the applied math notes for last week. Hope these helped a bit.